You are listening. You are listening to You are listening to KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign.
All writers are prone to becoming so attached to our characters and stories that we struggle to see why a passage may not be working. It takes another set of eyes to help us nurture our writing into full maturity. At Black Wolf Editorial Services, we strive to enable writers to develop and grow, shaping stories into masterpieces that can stand the test of time. Editing services are provided for all genres and all age categories. Services range from critiques of the short story through to the line edits of the full-length novel and copy editing for those preparing for publication. We also offer assistance on generating a writer's bio for your website, as well as help with those book blurbs and promotional material. We won't abandon you to the masses. We want to celebrate with you and your successes. Black Wolf Editorial Services, nurturing your writing into maturity. For a full list of services and prices, visit us at blackwolfeditorial.com.
Individuals and businesses with tax problems, listen carefully. Do you feel like you're losing control over your finances? If you owe over $10,000 in back taxes or have unfiled tax returns, we can help you take back control. The IRS is the largest and most aggressive collection agency in the world, and they can seize your bank account, garnish your paycheck, close your business, and file criminal charges. Take control of your tax problems now by calling the experts at Tax Mediation Services and take advantage of the Fresh Start program and new laws that may allow us to negotiate a settlement for the lowest amount possible. Our team of tax attorneys and enrolled agents can stop collections and get you protected so you can take control of your financial future. Tax Mediation Services is accredited by the Better Business Bureau. Call now for a free case review and a price protection guaranteed quote.
Call Tax Mediation Services now at 800-610-9050. That's 800-610-9050. 800-610-9050.
Welcome to Opinion Nation.
And we stand today on the edge of a new frontier.
There is nothing wrong with America that cannot be cured by what is right with America.
What makes us Americans is our shared commitment to an ideal that all of us are created equal.
I, too, am America.
Now here's your host, Bryce Robbins.
Hello, everybody. What a beautiful Saturday morning, coming to you live August 13th from sunny New Jersey. Now, I was actually just realizing that soon I'm not going to get to say that anymore. I'll be saying coming to you live from Washington, D.C. So my days in New Jersey are numbered. Just had to get that out there. All right. Today at 11:30, we're supposed to have Dr. Jill Stein of the Green Party coming on our show, and we're going to talk a lot about the military, we're going to talk about terrorism, we're going to talk about her policies and her running as a third-party candidate. But before we do so, I'm going to have my co-host on Finding Common Ground, Rowdy Ricky Robinson, join me to discuss third-party candidates, their viability, the, I guess, need for them or the not need for them, and we're going to have a real discussion before a major third-party candidate member, I guess you would call it, comes on the show. So, Rowdy Rick Robinson from America Off the Rails, how are you doing?
I'm doing all right, Bryce. And the short answer to your first question is yes, we have, if in my opinion, a desperate need for third parties because they're, you can't even really call them the third party anymore because the main parties are basically just mirrors of one another at this point. So yeah, we need other choices. Honestly, I'm coming around to the mindset of we need as many choices as possible so that we can start making sure that things actually get changed and fixed instead of the, well, we're only going to be able to fix it if you vote for the Republicans. Oh, if you vote for the Republicans, they're going to build a wall and they're going to put all your money into the military, and that's bad. Look, it's all bad. It all sucks. It all stinks. Politics was never supposed to be a lifetime career appointment. It was supposed to be public service. Now we're basically their servants, not the other way around, and that's the biggest thing that needs to be fixed.
All right, but what I'm a little confused about here is, you know, I was listening to a recent interview with Obama, and I think he was on, like, CNN or something, and he was talking about the need for a stronger two-party. You know, when the two parties work together, we have a stronger two-party system, and that's good for America. But then that completely contradicts the ideas of the founding fathers, right? We look at George Washington's farewell address, and he talks about how we need to get rid of the two-party system. We cannot have, or not two-party system, but he said we cannot have political parties. So I guess my question is, if we take Washington's advice, won't we inevitably come back to having, you know, multiple parties? I mean, aren't parties kind of an inevitable feature of any political arena?
Well, I mean, the simple fact of the matter is it goes back to basic human sociology. We are an animal that prefers to be in groups. Plain, simple, period. That's why for even in smaller groups, we had villages, we had tribes, families. The simple fact of the matter is we don't like to be alone. We also like to be around people that hold the same ideas that we do, which is why political parties eventually came into play, even though, if you want my honest opinion, they are completely terrible ideas. But that's why I think that we need as many parties as possible, because then what we could do, because again, we're tribal, always have been, always will be, it's never going to change. What we could do is start putting up people that have differing ideas, and instead of it always being narrowed down to just the two biggest people that have the biggest draw on the stage, we should be letting people make decisions based on other people's viewpoints. I mean, think of it this way. There was an oldish, because now it's been remade, show Battlestar Galactica that had this group called the Quorum of 12. In my opinion, the political parties should be basically a group where eventually what winds up happening is the people that wind up securing the most votes within their own nomination process all get to get up on the stage and they all get to give their viewpoints so that people can actually vote for the one that they most align with. The problem that we have in this country is, and I don't know if you know this or not, But in 2016, there are approximately 1,800 different people running for president. How many do you know about?
That's a fair point. And I definitely see, well, you can see in legislation how, you know, it's almost corrupted in that way, that it bars out independents. It bars out people of third parties. I mean, you were stating, and I've seen it on the news many times, that in order to even get on the debate stage, you need 15% in the polls. But then again, in order to even stay on the ballot in the state for the following year in some states, you need to still keep 15%. So, I mean, to me, this just seems a way to keep minor parties with differing ideas out.
It is. It's a system that's been rigged by the two major parties. And what happened, and the reason why it happened, the reason why it got this way, is because it's no different than when Lyndon Baines Johnson turned on his own party and passed the civil rights stuff, because he knew that if he could do it, he could secure their vote. I'm not going to use the language that he used. You can go back and you can look it up. But he actually did say what he said, and there was a reason why he said it. What the parties became afraid of is, before the Republican Party came into existence, there were the Whigs and the Democrats. The Whigs basically imploded, a lot like what we're watching the Republican Party do today, and the Republican Party was forged out of the ashes of that. There were some very significant people from the Whig Party who managed to graft themselves into the new Republican Party, and what they set aside to start doing was making sure that what happened then could never happen again, or at least if it did, it was going to be very difficult. And as technology has outpaced their ability to keep up with it, they've continued to stack the deck. You mentioned that 15% in a poll to be able to get a third party on the stage. It's not that simple. It's 15% in five polls. Not five consecutive polls. Five polls. The group that decides that gets to pick the polls. The person that's being represented in those polls that wants to see if their party can be in five polls and make the 15% as an average and get on the stage, they don't even have to be part of the sampling for that poll to count. So in theory, what they could do is they could pick three polls with, let's say Jill Stein was at 15% in two polls and it started making people nervous. So they pick the two polls where she's at 15% just to make it look legit. Then they pick three polls that she's not in there. By the time you take 30 and divide it by five, you get six. So it makes sure that she's not anywhere near the threshold. The same thing can happen with the Libertarian Party, and it likely will happen with Johnson this year, because he's at 12% right now polling nationally. In some polls, they are already showing him near the 15% mark. But when the folks that set the rules pick the polls, Johnson doesn't even have to be in there for it to count. And that's my problem.
My question now is, but what I don't understand and what I've heard said best is that we're inevitably going to come back to two parties. And what I mean by that is, you know, you have the Democrats and, let's say, the Green Party, and we have the Libertarians and the Republican Party. Those two kind of align with each other best. So won't the Republicans just take the great ideas from the Libertarian Party? And won't the Democrats just take the good ideas from the Green Party? We're back at the same place with two parties that just gobbled up bigger platforms. Won't that just inevitably happen over and over again?
If they were going to do that, why haven't they done it before now?
Well, I mean, they are. And as I don't know if you watch the show Shark Tank as much as I do, but
actually,
you know,
I prefer Dragon's Den.
Okay, well, you know.
You know what Dragon's Den is, don't you?
I actually don't.
It's the British version of Shark Tank that's been on about 5 years longer.
Oh, okay. Well, on the Shark Tank I watch, you know, Kevin O'Leary always says, there's nothing proprietary about your idea. There's nothing proprietary, obviously, about the Green Party or Libertarian Party, which it seems that the Republicans and Democrats are just going to gobble up what they seem that's best. And we already saw Hillary Clinton do it with Bernie Sanders supporters. She said, oh, we're going to appoint justices that will overturn Citizens United. Where do you think that came from? That obviously
came as
an attempt to grab ideas.
No. It wasn't an attempt to grab ideas. It was an attempt to grab votes. I bet
that's what I meant.
I bet you $500 she doesn't do half of what she says she's going to do. And the sad thing is, at this point, she's going to be the president. There's no way around it. Because, if for anybody who's actually paying attention, there is no way that they can seriously think that Donald Trump wants to be president. Because he keeps white-knighting Hillary anytime the press comes into play. And again, just to show you how colluded this whole election cycle has been and the fact that they're not hiding it, Hillary Clinton's daughter and Donald Trump's daughter are friends. They've been friends for a very long time.
Yeah.
Donald Trump talked to Bill Clinton before he decided to run. You tell me what you think that call was about, because I'll tell you what that call was about. Look, I understand that everybody thinks the Republicans made a big deal about nothing when it came to the email scandal. Maybe they did, maybe they didn't. But there are all kinds of other things that have been coming out that keep being swept under the rug. There's all of these different issues of impropriety throughout the time that she was Secretary of State. There's all these weird connections with their charitable foundation. They knew all of these things were going to come out in the news. And they knew that if there was a strong conservative candidate on the other side, that they were never going to be able to weather that storm. So what did they do? They called on their friend, the reality TV show star, who understands how to get a crowd worked up and understands how to draw attention. And that's what he does. Anytime the press starts seriously looking at Hillary Clinton, he shoves his foot so far in his mouth, he's got it coming out his rear end.
But now, Rick, and it's kind of getting off topic here, but I'm actually, it kind of comes back to, you know, full circle. With Donald Trump, I cannot picture him giving a legitimate concession speech when he loses. And I almost think that there's going to be a rip in the space-time continuum when that day comes. Because I don't think it's possible he can take the loss. So my question is, do you think he's going to try to make, as he did before, I mean, he had the Reform Party. He tried to join that and make it big. Do you think he's going to do the same thing if and when he loses? He's just going to try to jump ships and make another party and try to rev up the engines of...
No, I don't think at this point he has any interest in politics. I think he's found it a way to be an engine for him as far as publicity, even bigger than his reality TV shows. Because let's think about it for a second. The Apprentice had what type of ratings? What, about 5-6% of market share? This election cycle has had more people paying attention to it than any election cycle in history. And it's all been focused around him. He knows how to work a crowd. He knows how to draw attention. What he's going to do is exactly what he said he was going to do, and he hasn't told anybody else yet, which is he's going to start a news channel, a news network. Because...
Sounds just like Sarah Palin. I mean, it's the same thing. If you remember, she got her own show after her presidential candidate.
Well, yeah, but it's going to be even worse with him, because he's going to build his own network, and I guarantee you that Roger Ailes has a job. Just saying.
I guarantee you every... Yeah. No, I can get... I guarantee he's going to bring over everybody from Fox News except for Megyn Kelly. You know, I just think it's insane, his run. And the fact is that people are supporting him in... And you say, you know, what he's saying is racist and it's bigoted and it's rooted in fear. A lot of these people won't agree with that. But the fact of the matter is that many of his statements are. I mean, it doesn't take a quick look to realize. I mean, it only takes a quick look to realize what he's saying is backwards, to put it simply. And you could, I mean, actually, I kind of want to hear from your point of view as a person who's now looking for, I guess I would say, a third party. You are a disenfranchised Republican because of Donald Trump. So actually, if you could tell our listeners, what made you, I guess, jump the ship and say, I'm out. I'm not doing this anymore. I'm looking for a third party.
Well, it's pretty simple, actually. Hang on. Let me see if I can find something that I have sitting here that I used for something else. Nope, that's not the one. Hang on.
So, just for anyone who doesn't know, Rick is also the producer of Opinion Nation, always pressing the buttons behind the scenes. So I got to give him a shout out for that. Always got to make sure he's staying alert while his ears are bleeding to the liberal nonsense that always goes on. But, here we go.
We had you on the program.
No, that's not the right one. Never mind. All right, so let me tell you what the turning point was for me for Donald Trump, because I've said it on pretty much every show I've done when anybody's asked me this question. For about the first 2 months that he was running, I wasn't on board the Trump train, but I was considering purchasing a ticket because I liked when he came on the scenes and he told people what he thought. And it was refreshing because we've had this whole circulation of this, we have to be politically correct, we always have to remain proper, etc. But there has to be some sense of decorum. Donald Trump doesn't have that. When I started having the biggest problems with Donald Trump was when you started seeing all of the completely over-the-top attacks, whether it was attacking a fellow conservative, in air quotes, or whether it was... The first thing that really started sending up red flags for me was when he attacked the reporter with the congenital birth defect, because I have two special needs children, and that was one of the first things that made me realize this is not someone that we need to have basically unfettered power. I mean, everybody talks about the president basically being a figurehead. That's not necessarily entirely true. They can't make policy on their own, but they can steer the ship. And that's one of the reasons why we have had such a hard time, in my opinion, over the last 8 years. I mean, there are some things that Obama has done that I have to give him credit for. There are some things that Obama has done that I think are completely abhorrent. One of them, and actually there is a clip that I guess can play that wasn't the beginning of it, but this is one of the reasons why I really do think that... Actually, I guess I pulled that one from the board too, so never mind. So anyway, just kind of an example of more recent history. There was a recent clip of Donald Trump stating that President Obama should be labeled as the founder of ISIS. Now look, as a conservative, I will tell you that the Obama policies and the policies of Congress have led to ISIS being as powerful as they are, but that doesn't mean that he should have phrased it as him being the founder. He could have phrased it in a much different way that would have brought a lot more people to the table and possibly even right around to his way of thinking when it comes down to it, because we are directly responsible for the creation of ISIS all the way back to the Bush administration when we took it upon ourselves to topple a dictator. Hindsight's 2020. If you think that Saddam should have been left in place and that the world would probably be a more stable place, the only thing I can say to you is that the people that were being tortured and maligned by that government probably don't feel exactly the same way that you do. But my whole point is he has no sense of decorum, absolutely no idea about public policy. He has actually said during a debate that was watched by millions that he would give unlawful orders to our military were he commander-in-chief, and they would follow them because he told them that he had to. So in other words, we actually, you know, they talk about the Simpsons at predicting the future, you know, because way back when they were like Trump for president. Well, now have a presidential candidate acting like a cartoon character because Donald Trump seems to think that he's Mojo Jojo. You will do these things that I have told you to do because I've told you to do them because I am Mojo Jojo. And for those of you...
I'm surprised you know who Mojo Jojo is.
Dude, I had children around that age. Come on.
All right, fair enough. Now, real quick, because we're going to go to break in a couple minutes... When we get back, everybody, Jill Stein should be with us, and we're going to talk about a lot of policies, specifically pertaining to the military and foreign policy, something that kind of escapes some third-party candidates, so I definitely want to shine some light onto that. I've listened, I've taken many of your questions that you've sent or emailed to me, so here, if your question is asked, please make sure to send, input and your feelings, I guess, to me at Bryce at KLRNradio.com. I got to get used to the new business email.
I know, right?
Also, what was that? Sorry.
I said I know, right?
Yeah. Also, before we just get back to our conversation in the next couple minutes, so we at KLRN are very proud of our sponsors and are very proud of, you know, the fan base that we have built up. So we definitely encourage you to check out our new website, klrnradio.com, where you can check out a full list of show schedules, our shows in their entirety. And you can also, if you would like, go check out the donations button because, you know, we don't keep the lights on for free, folks. But, you know, any donation is welcomed. Make sure to check out our website.
Damn you, Edison.
Pretty well, right?
Yeah. Damn you, Edison. If Tesla had won that argument, we might have free electricity. Just saying.
So basically in the countdown for Jill Stein to come on the show, You know, kind of a fun interview you're going to have. Probably the biggest name I've had on my show, I'd say, since Jim Gilmore came on, almost a year ago he came on. Maybe a little less. No, it was a little less. Probably like last fall or something. But, yeah, so this is definitely interesting. So, Rick, tell me, before you have big, fun interviews, what is your, you know, prep? What do you do? When you had John Sununu on, for example, I don't know who your biggest interviewer was, but what is your pregame as a big radio show host that you are?
Sitting in a corner, rocking back and forth, praying I don't screw things up.
Right. I feel as though we listen to people in the media doing these interviews, but you got to get a little nervous. Like when I watch the people on CNN or even, you know, Jon Stewart on Comedy Central when he interviews Obama, your palms got to get a little sweaty, I imagine.
I will be completely honest. I have been doing this now for nearly 8 years, and I still get butterflies every time I flip the switch. But when I have a big guest on, when I interviewed Jon Sununu, it was really when the show was just really starting to get popular. It's been, God, almost 3 years ago now. And first of all, it was a Hail Mary in the first place. I found his Twitter account, and I'm like, hey, I saw you got a book. You want to come on and talk about it? I'm thinking, yeah, I'm never going to hear from this guy. All of a sudden, he's like, hey, shoot an email to this person. Next thing I know, like 3 months later, they're coming on my show. So my prep work for like that whole 3 weeks was, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God, I got Jon Sununu. I don't know what I'm going to talk about, but by God, I got Jon Sununu. That was basically my prep work.
I basically felt the same way with Jill Stein. I really wasn't expecting to get her, but I'm glad I did. And I definitely have a lot of tough questions to ask because I really feel as though politicians are not held accountable for some of the things they say. And I'm glad, she's ready. So we are going to go to break right now. When we get back, we are going to have Jill Stein online with us, to answer some questions. So stay tuned for more Opinionation with Jill Stein. I'm Bryce Robbins. We'll see you after the break, everybody. Stay tuned.
You are listening to KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign.
Prone to becoming so attached to our characters and stories that we struggle to see why a passage may not be working. It takes another set of eyes to help us nurture our writing to full maturity. At Black Wolf Editorial Services, we strive to enable writers to develop and grow, shaping stories into masterpieces that can stand the test of time. Editing services are provided for all genres and all age categories. Services range from critiques of the short story through to the line edits of the full-length novel and copy editing for those preparing for publication. We also offer assistance on generating a writer's bio for your website, as well as help with those book blurbs and promotional material. We won't abandon you to the masses. We want to celebrate with you and your successes. Black Wolf Editorial Services, nurturing your writing into maturity. For a full list of services and prices, visit us at blackwolfeditorial.com.
Individuals and businesses with tax problems, listen carefully. Do you feel like you're losing control over your finances? If you owe over $10,000 in back taxes or have unfiled tax returns, we can help you take back control. The IRS is the largest and most aggressive collection agency in the world, and they can seize your bank account, garnish your paycheck, close your business, and file criminal charges. Take control of your tax problems now by calling the experts at Tax Mediation Services and take advantage of the Fresh Start program and new laws that may allow us to negotiate a settlement for the lowest amount possible. Our team of tax attorneys and enrolled agents can stop collections and get you protected so you can take control of your financial future. Tax Mediation Services is accredited by the Better Business Bureau. Call now for a free case review and a price protection guaranteed quote. Call Tax Mediation Services now at 800-610-9050. That's 800-610-9050. 800-610-9050.
KLRN Radio has advertising rates available. We have rates to fit almost any budget. Contact us at advertising@klrnradio.com.
This is Slickery Trigger for Rebel Road Tactical. With proper care and feeding, your pistol will be ready when you need it, there to save your life. Shouldn't your gear be that good? Whether you need a holster for comfortable everyday carry or a tough-as-nails holster for your next training course, Rebel Road Tactical has what you need. Check us out on the web at rebelroadtactical.com.
All right, welcome back, and we are now joined with Green Party candidate Dr. Jill Stein. How are you doing today?
I'm doing great, Bryce. It's really great to be with you.
All right, thank you. So let's just jump right in. So, Dr. Stein, I want to talk a little bit about the military and foreign policy. So you want to ban the use of drones? However, according to a recent CIA report and an article in the New York Times, it turns out that not only drones are cheaper, but they actually cost less collateral damage in the sense that they are killing less civilians. And this is a direct quote, drones kill less civilians than any other military weapon. So why ban drones if they have proven to be safer, more effective, and the best option for taking out terrorists?
Well, you know, studies also show that for every terrorist that's an intended target, drones actually kill 9 other people who are not intended targets. So, you know, that's a 90% excess kill rate. And for the one person they kill, that is an assassination, actually, in which assumptions are made about people where not very much is known. So this is actually against international law. We know that where drones have been used, we have poisoned the waters and greatly accelerated the Dr. resistance Stein. Against the U.S. So it's extremely counterproductive as well as against international law. So this is part. I would look at the big picture here for a moment. It's not just a question of drones. It's also the whole war effort, which is a massive catastrophic failure that has cost us $6 trillion since the World Trade Towers, and which is only creating failed states, mass refugee migrations, and worse terrorist threats. So you don't want to go there. This is not the way to deal with world problems.
Okay, so I just want to tell you, from according to the New York Times, they said that of the 152 people thus far killed by drones this year, 3 of them were civilians. So what is the alternative to combating terrorism once these drones are gone?
So those figures quoted by the New York Times are figures, I believe, that come from, you know, U.S. intelligence, which is, shall we say, presenting the rosy side of the picture. There are other studies that massively dispute that. And regardless of the numbers, it's clear that the drone policy has been a massive failure, and that where drones have been used, like in Pakistan and in Somalia and Yemen, they have, and this is very well documented, the book Dirty Wars and the movie Dirty Wars, for example, describe how the drones were used in Yemen and how they really massively increased numbers of terrorists. So
okay,
you have to have the blinders on to take the New York Times. Remember, what did the New York Times tell us about weapons of mass destruction? You know, you got to be really, you got to bring some skepticism to what you're reading here.
Okay, so this is a two-part question. So in your platform, you call for shutting down 700 foreign U.S. military bases around the globe and cut to the military budget by 50%. Now, won't shutting down 700 bases send a message to countries like China and Russia to continue to grow their power in their regions and bully their parts of the world as they kind of already are? And in respect to the 50%, I want to know, where did you get the number 50%? Is it arbitrary? Did you pick it out of a hat? Did somebody tell you 50% would be optimal? I mean, I just want to know those two things. Where did the number come from? And do you think that closing down 700 bases could lead to a growth of, you know, China and Russia bullying and harassing their neighbors?
So let's just draw back and look at the big picture here. It's important not to miss the forest through the trees. So number one, let's recognize that half of our discretionary budget is going to the military right now. 54%, in fact, of our discretionary budget. And that's about half of your income taxes. And what are we getting for this? And also remember this. 54% is the portion taken by the military. The next biggest line item, second biggest to the military, is 7%. So essentially our budget right now, our tax dollars and our resources are consumed by the military. Do you know how many bases all the other countries have around the world? How many foreign bases? So we have somewhere over 700. All other countries put together have about 30. What's wrong with this picture? You know, what's wrong with this picture is that we have a massive military-industrial complex, which is not making us safer. And the reason we call for cutting this in half is that that's where we were before we pumped up this massive war on terror, which has only created more terror. Now, the other side of this is that budget is bankrupting us financially and morally, and creating a terrible image of the U.S. around the world. And also remember here, we're not just talking about cutting a dangerous military budget that gets us into more trouble. We're talking about funding the things that the American people are clamoring for. And that means we need jobs, we need an emergency jobs program, and we need to combat the greatest threat of all, to all countries, in fact, and that's climate change. So what we're arguing for is that we all need, in fact, to demilitarize our budgets so that we can combat our common enemy, which, by the way, as we move to 100% clean renewable energy, guess what? We don't need the wars and the foreign bases anyhow, which are about safeguarding our access to foreign oil and routes of transportation.
But do you think that China and Russia will seize this as an advantage to grow their power, especially China in the South China Sea? Don't you think that this is a prime opportunity? And again,
well, you know, it's worth noting what's at stake in the South China Sea. It's basically a fight over access to oil. So as we and the rest of the world move towards a green economy, we make these wars for oil obsolete. And yes, China does have to respect international law here, but it's, you know, China's also responding to the threat of the U.S. pivot. So how would we be feeling right now if, say, Russian missiles and troops and bases were aligned around our border? If Russia was pivoting to North America, you know, this would be like the Cuban Missile Crisis. So we need to use diplomacy here and defuse this situation, which is entirely doable, but not when you have a military-industrial complex which is calling the shots and is looking to beef up an already staggering military budget.
And where do you get the 50% number from?
That's where our budget was before the war on terror.
Okay.
So we don't need this bloated military budget. And you know what? The big expenses here, you know, are like for the F-35 weapon system, which isn't even, you know, it's hardly going to be usable. Even the Pentagon doesn't want it.
No,
so
I agree
we
with
have
that.
This incredibly bloated military budget, which is just robbing us blind.
All right, so
we need a truly defense budget. Right now we have an offense budget, which embroils us in these wars that are very dangerous for everyone.
So, Dr. Stein, after all the cuts to the budget are made and the bases are gone and the drones are gone, what is your plan to combat ISIS?
Oh, well, we need to stop the flow of weapons to ISIS. We and our allies, I don't know if you know about the history of these terror movements. Right, so ISIS grew out of the chaos created by the war on terror
in Iraq.
And
Al-Qaeda, in turn, grew out of the effort to buff up the terrorist movement against the Soviet Union in Afghanistan. So that, you know, that, and that was started by who? You know, we and the Saudis basically created the Mujahideen as an international terrorist movement. So at each turn of the cycle of violence here, the terrorist movement gets worse. But unfortunately, either the U.S. or our allies have been funding, arming, and training terrorist movements from the get-go. And Hillary Clinton herself wrote as much in a State Department memo that the main funder of international Sunni jihad now is still the Saudis. So what we're calling for is a weapons embargo to stop the funding of ISIS and also a freeze. A weapons embargo to stop the arming of ISIS and the flow of weapons, because the U.S. is providing the majority of weapons and essentially arming all sides, either the U.S. or our allies. And the same is true for the funding. So we started the problem. We have the capacity to shut it down by stopping the flow of arms, stopping the funding, and also working with our allies, Turkey, to close off their border to the flow of jihadi militias. That's how you shut ISIS down. More war is guaranteed to give us only the next, even worse, terrorist movement. It's important to look at the record here. You don't want to keep doing a massively and drastically failed
territory. What do we do if ISIS continues to expand its territory, but we aren't using drones, our budget is cut, and our bases are gone?
Because we have to stop arming ISIS.
No, I know we have to stop arming them,
create
but what
a weapons embargo to the region. Well, once you stop arming them and you stop funding them, they're gone. Are you suggesting we just keep doing more of the same? You know, more of a failed policy that clearly hasn't worked. It's time to use diplomacy. So it's really been great talking with you. I'm afraid I'm going to have to move on to my next call, but really good talking with you, and all the best on your program and in the work that you're doing.
Oh, Dr. Stein, you're leaving?
Yes, I'm afraid I'm going to have to go. I'm up against my time limit.
Can I ask you one more question?
One last quick one. One last quick one.
My last question. So there was a recent Real Clear Politics article that said, let's not forget Nader elected Bush. If 10 years from now it said Stein elected Trump, would you be happy that you ran, or would you regret not following Bernie Sanders and uniting liberals in a common interest?
So you need to enlarge your sources. If you're reading one source who says one thing, you know, you need to read other sources as well. Any of the small parties won enough votes in Florida that made the margin of difference. Remember, it was the Supreme Court that stopped the vote recount. Al Gore would have won. Continued. We are in a very different place now than we were in the year 2000. The majority of voters now has rejected the Democratic and Republican parties. 50% of voters identify now as independents. Democrats represent 29%, Republicans 21%, according to last summer's Wall Street Journal poll, which was their most recent. So we're in a very different place, where the majority of voters have rejected the parties and consider these two candidates, Trump and Clinton, the most untrustworthy and the most disliked candidates ever in our history. And there are some pundits out there and some apologists for the political parties from the establishment who are telling the public who is in revolt to just be good little boys and girls and take your marching orders from the heads of the parties, and just keep shooting yourself in the foot here by voting for more of the same. Unfortunately, it's not just the military that's draining our dollars. Our jobs are going overseas, thanks to the Trans-Pacific Partnership being pushed by the Democrats, the NAFTA, which was signed by Bill Clinton and promoted and approved and celebrated by Hillary Clinton. You had the Wall Street bailouts.
again brought to us by the Democrats, and the deregulation of Wall Street actually brought to us by the Democrats, creating the Wall Street meltdown, the disappearance of 9 million jobs, and the theft of 5 million homes. So the American people has kind of had it with being told to just vote for more of these predatory political parties who are funded by the big banks, the fossil fuel giants, and the war profiteers. So it's time. The American people are standing up and are discovering that we actually have the power that it takes. We have the solutions. And above all, there are 42 million young people who are in predatory student loan debt with no way to get out of it. And ours is the only campaign that will bail them out like the establishment party.
And how is that possible? How are you going to bail them out?
That, and what that 42 million people can do, actually, is come out and win that vote. They can take over the election. And as that happens, people are standing up, word is getting out, and we do, in fact, have the power to take our future back. As to how to do that bailout, we didn't have any trouble figuring out how to come up with $17 trillion for Wall Street. So we can certainly come out with $1.5 trillion to bail out the young people who are the victims of that waste, fraud, and abuse. So I will leave you now back to the rest of your program. And again, thank you so much. Good talking. Take care. Bye-bye.
All right, you too. Bye-bye, Dr. Stein. Have a good day. All right, so that was Dr. Jill Stein, who just kind of came on the air with us. I hope, I just asked some honest questions that are in her platform about the United States military. And, you can decide whether or not that she is prepared to take on the oath of office. And look, I'm a liberal, right? I'm a Democrat, and I was a Bernie supporter. But when asking questions, we have to be sure, we're going to be kept safe. When asking about the 700 military bases, when asking about the 50% cut into the budget, personally, I don't know if Dr. Stein came up with these numbers herself or if they are her ideas that she came up with in, thinking about them at night or in the shower. But I don't know if these were numbers that were planned strategically. Now, I actually had a time slot allotted for a little bit longer. I think she left kind of angered. So I don't know if Jill Stein will be back on the program.
Angry. Dude, she's never going to talk to you again. I'm just saying.
That's fine. Look, I asked her honest questions. They were all in her platform. If she doesn't like it, change your platform. But see, I was going to ask her next, many people say that your plans are idealistic and that you actually have no plan to back up your statements. And I was going to ask if you feel that her platform was rhetoric to quickly grab Bernie supporters. Now, I can see she kept trying to move it back to climate change, move it back to the fossil fuel industry, move it back to student loan debt. But at the end of the day, the military is a huge part of a presidential candidate's platform. And it was evident that her platform for the military is lacking drastically. Again, I am a liberal. I support, everything, almost everything with a plan that's logical to stop climate change. One day I intend to run for office as a liberal, and I hope somebody holds me accountable for everything I put out there as well. But I think
you already have run for political office. So how are you going to fix your school board, sir?
Oh, well, how am I going to fix my school board? Well, there's going to be interviews that will come along for that. You want to check out my actual page, go to Bryce Robbins for the Leonia Board of Education. Email me there at info.bryce@gmail.com. But I want to stick
nice to... Nice deflection, sir. Nice deflection.
Thank
Just
you.
Playing.
Thank you. I'm working on my political savviness. But I want to stick with Jill Stein for the last 10 minutes of our show. Rick, come on. In the nicest way you can put it, I mean, her knowledge of the military and her...
is no worse than Trump's.
What? I'm sorry, I didn't hear you.
You said her knowledge of the military, and I said is no worse than Trump's.
I mean, yeah, and that's unfortunate. And this clearly, it shows a lack of readiness to be president?
Not really. I mean, Barack Obama got 8 years of on-the-job training.
Oh, my God. And Obama has killed more, taken out more terrorists than anybody else with, might I add, the use of drones, which has been his weapon of choice. But, for example, I want to get to that.
But hang on. See, let's stay on this topic for a second. Because didn't he run as the anti-war candidate?
Wait, I don't want to talk about Obama right now. We're going to save that for another time. This is Jill Stein's episode still. I want to stick to Jill Stein.
Who's pushing the button, Skippy?
All right, so with Jill Stein, she wants to ban drones. But if we're looking at the CIA reports and we're looking at the New York Times, they're stating that, and I'll read you the quote.
Because the CIA tells us the truth all day, every day.
But Rick, drones are killing, and these are quotes. I mean, I can either state the facts that I'm getting from the CIA, that I'm getting from the New York Times, that I'm getting from all these sources that are saying that drones are killing less civilians than any other military weapon. And they're the most effective weapon, and they keep our troops safe and out of harm's way.
But
I don't understand is why you would want to ban that. And when I asked...
Oh, no, I never said I did. But it's interesting that you pointed out that drones are killing less civilians than terrorists. If it can only save one life, isn't that the argument you guys use for gun control? Just saying, maybe we need some drone control.
Rick, this is not finding common ground. Which, by the way, everybody listening, you can tune into. That's the show before this, where Rick and I kind of get a little loopy and out of control on various topics. But for now, I just want to...
No, serious question. You just said that drones are killing less civilians than they're killing terrorists.
That's what the facts are saying.
The simple fact of the matter is, in America, guns kill more criminals than criminals kill people with guns. So isn't that the same logic?
Rick, I'm not trying to talk about gun control. We can have this talk.
No, actually, we're talking about drone control, which I'm just trying to give you the reasoning for her logic. It's the same parallel that you guys draw for gun control. I'm not saying that I agree with her.
No, I understand that, but I'm just saying her logic is off. It's not there. There is no logic there.
Did you just call Dr. Jill Stein mental?
No, I'm not calling her mental. I'm just saying that she's illogical with her statement. Her statements don't make sense. If she wants to keep our country safe and if she wants to cut the military's budget, why would you not use the cheapest option to keep us safe, which are drones? I mean, look, I'm just presenting the facts. I'm just going after her platform. And if that's not okay, then her entire platform is just idealistic and lacks any type of research or common knowledge or any type of insight that goes into keeping our country safe. If you want to talk about climate change, let's talk to Jill Stein about that, but that's clearly not what this interview was about. See, I could have talked to her about, you know, how are we going to keep the earth clean? And I would have loved that because everybody knows I'm a huge environmentalist. But the fact of the matter is that's not the only job as president is to worry about the environment ecosystem as much as I think that should be a...
That's not what you said last week. No,
it should be a predominant issue within your cabinet. But keeping our country safe is another predominant, you know, factor that makes up the presidential cabinet. And just saying, oh, we're going to stop, you know, shipping weapons to people in the region makes absolutely no sense. In fact, she even talks about cutting military funding to countries like Israel, which I understand are not necessarily doing everything they can to make peace, but are sure as hell a much better nation than all of them surrounding. I mean, for example, Israel, and I've said this before, the only country in the Middle East, at least, that I can identify that is giving women equal rights to men, that is providing gay rights, that, you know, doesn't stone people for those types of things. So if you really want to target human rights abusers, I don't know why we're not applauding Israel for everything that they do. You know, I do think that Israel has its work cut out for itself if it really wants to achieve peace. But that's, again, a whole other topic for a whole other time. That actually, if you want to go check it out, go listen to the Carrie Wedler episode. She's a internet celebrity who's vehemently opposed to Israel. So go check that one out. But again, in reference to Jill Stein, this interview was not to be about what she likes. It was to be about what her platform is about.
I have a question about that. Did you let her know up front that this wasn't going to be a fluff piece? Because I'm telling you, she was literally felt blindsided, and she tried to drop out on you 10 minutes in after promising you at least 15. So she was mad, brother.
I told her, and I will read the interview, I said, the topics are going to be about the military, They're going to be about your platform in general and you as a third-party candidate. And the first thing I said was the military. Because, Rick, the entire job of the presidency is for the common defense of our country, is to defend our country. They are the commander-in-chief and not the, you know, the commander in sitting back and letting China and Russia take over half the world. I mean, we see what's happening in Ukraine. Donald Trump doesn't even realize that Russia's in Ukraine. We see what China's doing in the South China Sea. I mean, come on. We're going to leave Russia to the Middle East? We're going to leave Asia to China? I mean, our country at least stands for common principles and keeps countries safe. If we pulled out of China, I mean, out of the South China Sea area, or in Asia specifically, we would kiss Tibet, Vietnam, Laos, Taiwan, and even Hong Kong.
You said Taiwan twice.
Democracy and freedom, goodbye, because we are the only country that is keeping them, or at least stopping or halting the expansion of China. And look at Russia. When, and I applaud George Bush for doing this, and it's probably one of the only things I can agree with him on, is that when he put missiles in Turkey and Poland, he sent a message to Putin. The second we got rid of those missiles, look what he did. He went exactly for Ukraine. And I'm just trying to say, these countries are not like us, all right? And we can try and appease them and with peace and love, but at the end of the day, it just simply, it doesn't make sense for a presidential candidate to state that they are going to, oh, we're just going to pull out of everywhere. We're going to close down our 700 military. First of all, that's not realistic. She is pandering to a group of people who evidently aren't understanding what our military even does around the globe, doesn't appreciate what our military does around the globe. And also, well, I can agree that there's a lot of waste in the military. In fact, on our first interview, Rick, I talked about the F-35 being such a waste of money, and everybody I have on will agree with me that it is a waste of money, a colossal waste of money. Even the military doesn't like it. But that doesn't mean, and I even proved it in the interview, where does the 50% number come from? Oh, that was the number before the war on terror. We're in the war on terror. And again, I want to remind my folks, and my listeners and my fans and whoever, I am liberal. I am a Democrat and I'm not a hawk, but I'm not going to be naive.
You kind of sounding like a hawk right now. Not that I disagree with anything that you're saying. I'm just honestly surprised to hear you saying them, because I've said the same thing for a very long time. If it was possible to go back in time and stop us from being Team America World Police, I would probably be willing to do that, because I know we always start out with the best of intentions, but it usually winds up going sideways. Iraq being case in point, we've been in there now twice, and it's worse than when we left it the first time and the second time. So, I mean, if we could stop it, I would love to, but the issue with that is nature and politics are much the same animals. Nature abhors a vacuum, so does politics. As you mentioned, as soon as we showed weakness and pulled those missiles out of Turkey, Putin went for Crimea. The one thing back when Sarah Palin actually didn't sound exactly like the caricature of the lady that plays her on Saturday Night Live, the one thing that she kept pointing out back in the 2008 cycle was that if we kept on the path that we were going to be on, that Russia was going to invade Ukraine. And then eventually they did just that several years later, because we continued down the same path that we were on. So, I mean, I don't disagree with anything that you're saying, but the interesting thing is, in that respect, she sounds libertarian, because there are a lot of libertarians that are saying the exact same thing. We need to close our bases.
The Libertarian Party is giving a real number. Gary Johnson gives the number 20%. We're going to cut the military's budget 20%, because that's what the Pentagon is asking for.
Well, no, I know that. I'm not talking about Johnson's platform. I'm talking about the Libertarian Party as a whole wants us to pull out of every country that we're in. So she's mirroring a lot of what the Libertarian base actually wants.
But, all right, well, I mean, I guess that's maybe on the military, but if you look at her platform, she's anything but a Libertarian.
I understand that.
In the last minute, I just want to say, I'm glad we finally got to have Dr. Jill Stein on our show.
For the first time ever, and the last time.
This is going to be the first time and the last time we have Dr. Jill Stein on my show, but I want to make it very clear. I asked her about her platform. I am holding her accountable for the things she puts on her own website. You can go find them on her website. And really, go back, listen to the interview again, but it's your choice who you want to be president. I'm a liberal, but I'm not naive. I might be 17, but I'm just not that naive. All right? I'm Bryce Robbins. This is Opinion Nation. We'll be back next week for another episode, another installment of the show Opinion Nation. And don't forget to check out our new website, klrnradio.com. You can go check out other shows. You can go check out the schedule for shows. You can, if you want,
throw pennies to our show. Throw pennies. We'll take them.
Exactly. Even pennies. We'll take them. But please make sure to come back onto Opinion Nation next Saturday at 11 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. But until then, I'm Bryce Robbins, and I'll catch you next week. So long, everybody, and bye forever, Jill Stein.
It's nice having you on a show, Dr. Stein. Never again, I'm sure.